So I think this is absolutely ridiculous.
You've got one major fundamental flaw in the
Plonker. Twat. Schadenfreude is a German word. Come back to me. Come back to me, Steve. Schadenfreude is a German word translated to shameful joy, or literally, harm joy. You know, harm joy, the Mirror Universe's version of the antagonist in Deadwood. How witty, Steve. It is essentially finding pleasure in the misfortune of others. Here I'm going to briefly explain how Schadenfreude is utilized by reality TV, and how... Steve. Steve!
This season...
Why does everybody keep saying that it's not about me? Everything is about me!
Expect...
Schadenfreude, or more precisely, events and storytelling tools used to deliberately create a feeling of Schadenfreude in the audience, is used in all forms of narrative fiction. There are many examples of it in film. If you turned your TV on to see the last 15 minutes of a revenge film that uses it, the protagonist might seem unhinged and unlikable as they humiliate, kill, or at least inconvenience their nemesis and the film's antagonist. With context, however, and if the film works, watching it all the way through might lead you to seeing actions that without context seem extreme as justified and righteous, and share in the protagonist's satisfaction and relief in the final elimination of the bastard who killed his wife and kid, or drank all the high fructose corn syrup in the fridge and put the carton back anyway, or whatever.
I killed him. Right, Cleveland, I killed him.
Simply, for lots of films to work, we have to like the protagonist and dislike the antagonist, to a point where we want to see them experience some sort of misfortune, to some extent. The pleasure from seeing them experience misfortune is Schadenfreude. Psychologists have divvied up feelings of Schadenfreude as being aggression-based, rivalry-based, and justice-based. Essentially, aggression-based Schadenfreude is group identity-based. So a real-life example might be people feeling satisfaction from the suffering or the disappointment or misfortune of people who have different political or religious beliefs, are from a different social class, support a different wiffle bat team, really anything. I want to see you fail because you got me that Diwali card from funkypigeon.com, and I'm a moonpig sort of guy. I'm glad you've got leprosy because you support Knowledge Fiddlers FC, and I support Thrumblehead on Shadwick United. It's just there, around the mouth. You can often see this sort of Schadenfreude played out in war films, but more importantly, utilized there too. The Dirty Dozen, for example, at times comes across like it expects its audience to enjoy the slaying of people who, yes, are Nazis, but also to enjoy the slaying of Nazi wags. A demographic held in little regard by the group identity of the makers, i.e. not Nazis, who experienced the Second World War firsthand. I feel like a modern audience of Americans and British might have a little more sympathy for the people, especially the non-military people, getting exploded. But movie war crimes and how to enjoy them is next week. Rivalry-based Schadenfreude is essentially the same thing, but between individuals. I think most people have probably experienced this at some point in their lives. If you have a job with a colleague who has a very similar skill set and a set of experience as you, who gets promoted and who gets lavished with praise, you might feel that that's unfair. Then when they fail spectacularly, when they're humiliated, even though they never did anything wrong to you, you might feel good about that, about their failure. That's rivalry Schadenfreude. And although that often appears in narrative media, it's difficult to show an example of when narrative media wants the audience to feel it. It's much more personal than aggression-based Schadenfreude. If you hate X and you want X to get bad thing insert here because you hate fat people, that's aggression-based. If you hate X and you want X to get bad thing insert here because you hate him, that's rivalry-based. The last of the driving forces is justice-based schadenfreude, something perhaps so ubiquitous in the media and socially, it could be totally overlooked. Feel good when the baddie gets it? That's a type of schadenfreude. Feel satisfaction from Hollywood and Weinstein finally being convicted of the kind of crime he's been committing for decades? That too. So schadenfreude is both portrayed and used in narrative film. And now, here we come to reality TV. At last, thank God. Still there? Reality TV is different from factual TV. Steve, what are you doing? It focuses on real people being themselves, or perhaps more accurately, playing themselves, or perhaps more precisely, playing a version of themselves that is acutely aware that they're being filmed. Reality TV portrays real people with real problems, with real conflict, but it is different from otherwise factual TV. Reality TV is a different genre of programming to the traditional TV documentary or news report. It's about entertainment, really, not information.
This just won't do. We're alcoholics here.
Yeah, I know, right?
In a typical reality TV show, any editorializing usually focuses on entertainment and on creating an understandable and hopefully compelling narrative rather than the facts. And because of that, the inclusion of grandstanding and theatrics often comes at the expense of the linear, unadulterated truth. And that's necessary, of course. No one would watch Kitchen Nightmares if 3% of it was Gordon Ramsay flipping his lid and the rest of it was just him quietly watching someone burn frozen meat. Fresh frozen. Not all reality TV shows utilize schadenfreude, but many of them do, usually in an episodic way. Kitchen Nightmares is a show where renowned chef Gordon Ramsay plays a lunatic business consultant who, while making many good points, behaves in a way that would be considered unacceptable if there weren't any TV cameras and he'd just been hired.
But when Amy gave me a tour of her kitchen, things started getting a little strange.
I guess that's the trade-off the contestants make. Some of the episodes have Ramsay help poor struggling businesses who've fallen on hard times since some terrible personal tragedy, but most have him going toe-to-toe with deluded owners and lazy chefs.
This guy's out of control. You know, I think someone needs to put him in line.
Let me tell you something, man. For a guy to talk like that in front of me like that, I can't believe it.
And there really is a lot of catharsis in watching him bollock someone in a justified way. The more arrogant, the better.
He was alluding to my relationship with the waitresses.
You're such a fake.
Not fake, I'm just... Why are you saying I'm a fake?
Usually on the show, Ramsay finally gets through to the owners, who only yesterday were defending their fresh frozen tilapia pudding, but finally accept, oh yes, we asked you here, and you probably do know what you're talking about, at least more than our 23-year-old mole-faced chef. You know who you are.
Why did it take me to let you know that he's standing there playing with radishes?
Because,
you're busy.
The customers have been here 27 minutes, and they still haven't had a sniff of grub.
Okay, I'm gonna be nearly ready to go in a minute on the first table, yeah? Thank you.
Dragon's Den, named Shark Tank in the US because dragons don't exist in America, has a pretty rigid formula.
Put a plan.
You're
in place.
Not listening.
Well, no, I most certainly am.
Well, if I've been harsh and you have been listening, then it's been a great exercise.
The show has inventors, would-be entrepreneurs, and even actual entrepreneurs come in and offer a percentage of their business for investment. Usually at the end of the episode, the dragons invest.
Peter, I'd like to accept your offer.
Whee!
Great. Right, thank you, Jenny. Thank you very much.
Usually at some point, they don't invest but find a product interesting. And usually, at least once in an episode, someone comes in who is woefully underprepared, has unrealistic expectations, is hiding something fishy, or doesn't appropriately kowtow, the scum.
I'm about 50 and about a million in hard work.
Have you got any more money, Paul?
Of course I've got more money.
How much more money have you got?
Well, I don't think that concerns you.
Why should I give you money for you to get money from me?
Well, we're not a charity. We're not going to let you have equity.
What do you mean you're not a charity? You want knowledge from me and my money?
Absolutely.
Exactly.
Something like The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills is, of course, less formulaic, often observational at times, but with talking heads. Each series follows several wealthy women as they scream and shout their way through life. It's less formulaic than the almost game show format of Dragon's Loft or Kitchen Bastard, but it does have a formula, just one that plays out over seasons rather than episodes. A narrative is woven from the hundreds of hours of footage, so that the audience can follow it a bit like a soap opera, taking sides with their favourites. I think a significant element of the show's appeal is seeing these often entitled, vain, self-centred people, with more wealth and opportunity than almost anyone, humiliate themselves and even occasionally get a dressing down, if not a withering look, from Andy Cohen. Andy Cohen, what a bitch. I love him.
A comment that generated a lot of negativity. You said that black people can't swim.
I know.
What intentionally is being used here is the idea of the comeuppance of someone getting their just desserts. Justice-based schadenfreude. None of these shows feature people suffering without that suffering being corrected, without trying to make the audience feel like that suffering is deserved. On Dragon's Den, the investors might not be impressed with a nervous presentation, but they don't usually cut people down just for that. Instead, for something that is their fault, for not knowing the numbers, for greatly overvaluing their business, for thinking they are better than they are.
Doesn't that sound Indeed. A bit rich?
Nope, because it's got your interest.
No, actually, you just lost my interest.
And mine. Okay.
Portraying people, not necessarily incorrectly, as thinking that they're better than they actually are, is, I think, one of the most effective ways of getting the audience on side for that person's eventual comeuppance. For the misfortune we, the audience, are intended to enjoy. The pitch being vehemently rejected, the owner being bollocked, the selfish narcissist being exposed as in fact not being any better or any happier than anyone else. Even in the most basic offering of schadenfreude entertainment, the good old people falling down show, there's an element of this. Some of it is just presented without context. Oh, an old lady falls down. That's hilarious. But I think the successful clips, if you can call any of this sort of thing successful, are the ones where people get hurt because they were doing something really stupid. And what were they thinking? But I also think that schadenfreude plays a part in reality TV shows where the on-screen subjects don't necessarily undergo any misfortune, where their very existence is misfortunate. This is Car Crash TV, where the schadenfreude comes not from someone being an arse and getting their comeuppance, but from their miserable existences. This you can occasionally see in desperate to appear happy housewives, but whole shows are built around it.
Tell me what your concerns are.
My concerns are that we really need to put a dance floor down on this carpet because it's supposed to be like, it's supposed to make an amazing party.
In Bridezillas, or My Sweet 16, things don't usually go very wrong for the subjects of the episode. Instead, it's more that they're so entitled and spoilt, unrealistic and classless, that even if they're well off, they're not close to being enviable.
Loving the sunglasses.
Did you know? 25,000.
Insane.
That's right. I've got insecurity issues, apparently.
Wait, can I try them on just
yeah,
to say?
Yeah, no, totally.
From the outside, from the surface, it can look like these shows are celebrating these people. Surely that's how they're sold to people appearing there. Well, that and Don't You Want to Be on TV? But Real Housewives, Bridezillas, and all the rest aren't really celebrating them at all. They're lightly mocking them. The breakdowns, the bitchiness, the tantrums, they all make the cut for that reason.
My celebrity status is everything to me. I'm the ultimate celebrity, especially in Anchorage, Alaska.
And especially inside her own mind.
So, what's the conclusion? Well, I think reality TV is a very useful tool for understanding a society's values. And I think the element of schadenfreude in that genre goes a long way in that regard. There's something to be said about its disposable nature. The fact that it's easy to watch while you play on your phone and cook dinner after a long day at the benzene plant. And that despite that, it's important to most and critical to many examples to dress down, mock and humiliate fairly normal people.
I haven't done anything to
you. You believe you've been nothing but nice to Doreen?
I do.
Well, I'm afraid you're delusional.
And to be clear, I don't think it is especially cruel. It certainly seeks to create a justice-based schadenfreude, more than not. But even with its intention to create entertainment more than information, or to say anything, there is an element of cruelty there. So I will leave you with this example. This episode of Kitchen Nightmares is about a really dislikable guy. He's loud-mouthed, obnoxious, deluded, and he lies about his food. He isn't just offensive, he's abrasive.
Don't tell me that all this is because of me. He's full of fucking shit. I didn't like that. And next time that I see him in person, I'm gonna fucking tell him.
But in the episode, we later find that he started out working in his older brother's kitchen. His older brother was a hero to him, and 7 years before the filming of this episode, his brother died, and we can guess that he died very young. And I don't think it's a stretch to say that this man, this obnoxious man, has become what he is, at least in part, because of that. I would say, as a casual observer, that his behaviour is symptomatic of a protracted emotional breakdown. His hero, his brother, died, and suddenly he was alone.
Do you miss him?
Totally, because it's like now I would love to call him and ask for some advice. It's like I don't know where to turn. All has to come from me, and like I'm bombarded everywhere.
But if the show was more compassionate, if Ramsay was impenetrably calm, if the edit focused not on Sammy's personality flaws, but on his struggle, and didn't portray him as an extreme, but in fact what he is, a normal person, then I think the show would be less popular. There you go. That's the end. Thanks for watching. Why not subscribe, as if you didn't know that was an option? As some people have asked, I'll quickly say, the film's going well, it's in the edit, I'm getting the music done right now, I'm taking my sweet time with it, but there aren't any problems so far, so you'll have to wait for the schadenfreude for the end of that. Thanks for being patient. I know there's not been a lot of content lately, but I will get back to it. I miss it. Cheers. Bye.